One of the stories we've been doing since last week is the ludicrous decision by the Mayor's Office here in London, Sadiq Khan, to expand the ULEZ zone out to places like Dartford in Kent and parts of Essex as well, down to Orpington in the south, up to Hertfordshire in the north, west, out to Buckinghamshire. You know, really, really putting pressure on ordinary working men and women who need their cars or their vans to do their jobs. People like carers, for example, who are particularly vulnerable here because they don't make very much money and they're being asked to cough up £12.50 a day just to move their cars around. Absolutely extraordinary. Let's talk now to Gareth Bacon MP, who's a Conservative MP for Orpington. He's one of the signatories to a letter in the Daily Telegraph, which was sent a couple of days ago. Many MPs are signing it as well. I think Boris Johnson was one of them. Talking about how ludicrous this idea is, and yesterday we spoke to Professor Green, who's hoping to launch a petition. He represents Care UK and a lot of carers in this country, hoping to launch a petition and launch a campaign to get this decision reversed. Gareth, a very good morning to you. Welcome.
Good morning. How are you?
Yeah, very well indeed. I mean, it's extraordinary that public opinion in this particular case seems to be almost universally against the expansion of this zone, and yet the mayor went ahead and did it anyway.
Yeah, I mean, you said it yourself, it's a ludicrous decision. It's not based on scientific evidence. What it really is a cash grab dressed up as an environmental measure. Mm. It wasn't even in his manifesto. He stood for re-election last year, and his manifesto mentions extending the ultra-low emission zone to the North and South Circular in October 2021, which he subsequently did. Mm. But nothing at all about going to the boundaries of Greater London, and there is literally no reason to do it other than to raise money from
No. people. And at a time when people's, you know, expenses and people's lifestyles are under increasing financial pressure due to inflation, the rising price of energy and all of that, I mean, it's not exactly the greatest of timing, is it?
No, it's appalling. I mean, on the one hand, Sadiq Khan likes to grandstand and blame the government for cost of living pressures, and on the other hand, introduces a completely unnecessary measure which will cost people £4,500 a year mm. if they have non-compliant vehicles. And who are the people that will have non-compliant vehicles? By and large, it's going to be people on the poorer end of the economic spectrum. Mm. So he's hammering poor people to salve his own vanity,
yeah.
which I think is disgusting.
It really is. And also, has anybody looked into TfL recently? Because whenever I've looked into TfL, I've found a very over-bloated organisation full of fat cats, if you like, for want of a better word. The people working in there getting paid pretty well, even though sometimes they still go on strike. I mean, he's often said that he would never support a strike, but then when they do strike, he does support them. You know, the whole of TfL seems to be riddled with people getting paid too much money, and it seems to be just a massive money pit.
Well, it is. I mean, look, TfL perform a vital function, which is getting people around the city and getting people into work, etc. And that's very, very important. But what is absolutely undisputed is the number of people earning over £100,000 a year have gone up significantly.
Yeah.
They have private sector benefits at the same time as being a public sector organisation. So they have very generous leave entitlements. They have one of the best pensions you'll get anywhere. Mm. You know, flatmates of TfL employees get free travel paid for by the taxpayer. And this just goes on and on and on. And as you say, the mayor claimed that there would be no days of strikes when he was mayor because he was going to roll up his sleeves and work with the unions to make sure that happens. There have been more strike days under this mayor than either of his predecessors.
Yeah, it's been extraordinary, hasn't it? So, I mean, we spoke to Professor Green yesterday from the care community, and he was particularly vociferous about this. He's talking about launching a campaign and talking to MPs like yourself and obviously to the government, you would hope, to possibly try and influence the mayor's office, Sadiq Khan, to not do this. Is there any chance that could happen?
Well, I'm not hopeful simply because Sadiq Khan doesn't listen to anyone. If he did listen to people, he would have listened to the consultation. Mm. And we know from leaked documents that he's been trying to suppress that 66% of people who responded to the consultation said they didn't want him to do this. And 80% of businesses in Outer London, 70% of residents of Outer London said don't do this. Mm. And he's pressing on anyway. When he was looking into a boundary charge for Greater London, this is not as bad as that. But we had a look at how many police officers, for example, live outside Greater London. It's more than half. Mm. Same numbers for fire brigade. In my constituency, something like 40% of the people that work in my NHS hospitals live outside Greater London. A large proportion of the teachers do as well. All of these people, and care workers, and you've talked about care workers, they tend to be some of the lower paid workers. They need to get around in their cars.
Yeah.
for some of them, this is going to be the difference between working and not. And he's just not interested in listening to anybody. Mm.
Well, this is it. And I mean, the glibness that comes out of his office is full of people who say, oh, well, can't you take the bus? Or, you know, maybe you could cycle. Well, no, you can't take the bus or cycle in all circumstances, particularly where you are in Orpington, which is now going to be part of the proposed new zone. I mean, the sort of outskirts of London, you tend to have a very disparate bus service and probably no trains at all that go from the place you're in to the place you want to go. It's all very well if you want to go into Waterloo or if you want to go into London Bridge or if you want to go into a main station, but if you want to get from, say, you know, Orpington to, oh, I don't know, to Dartford by train, how do you do that?
Yeah, you can't. So what you end up having to do is go into London and come back out again.
Right.
So the train service is geared up for people that commute into the centre for work and then come back home again to go sleep. And that's fine. You know, the service is really not that bad. But if you want to get around, it's very, very difficult. Mm. If you come to places in my constituency like Biggin Hill, which is basically a rural town, the clue is in the title, a hill. It's very, very hilly. There's country lanes that you'll have to negotiate.
Right.
There's farmers' fields everywhere. The idea that you can cycle around everywhere really is implausible. That's fine if you're a lycra warrior and you're 25 years old.
Right.
But it's not great if you're a pensioner.
No. I mean, maybe they would recommend that you buy a horse or something and just ride around on that.
Well, I'm not sure that Sadiq Khan has ever been to Orpington, and if he has, it might have only been once or twice. But, you know, I'd very much like to take him around my constituency so he can see the challenges.
Yeah.
We don't have the tube. We don't have trams. The bus service, as you said, is intermittent. And he's imposing something on people who need their cars. They're not luxuries.
Yes.
We're not talking about people driving around in Rolls Royces.
No.
It really is a ridiculous proposal that just doesn't fit.
And I've also said the danger for a lot of people, particularly a lot of older people, is that they might find themselves getting caught by one of his many cameras that he's going to insert into the community without realising that they've been caught out, and they'll be fined and they'll be, you know, charged, they'll be chased by bailiffs, all of that horrible stuff that happens, you know, just because you've gone into a road that you didn't know was part of the zone.
Well, within Greater London, every road is going to be part of the zone because this is now going to go to the boundary.
Mm.
But if you live, so right next to my constituency, literally right on the border, is Sevenoaks. And, you know, so there are roads in my constituency that start inside Greater London and finish inside Kent. And you wouldn't necessarily know where the boundary is. So, you know, people may be visiting their mother-in-law or their children or something and inadvertently drive in without realising it. And then get absolutely hammered. Because that's the thing. It's not just about the people that live inside Greater London. It's about a lot of people that live just around the perimeter who need to come in and out of Greater London habitually.
Yes.
They're going to get caught by this. And it's going to be very, very damaging.
Absolutely right. Well, listen, Gareth, we're going to keep up this campaign here at TalkTV. We'll have you on again, I'm sure. Anything that happens, do let us know. We'll pass it on to anyone that can join the fight. Thank you very much indeed. Gareth Bacon, Conservative MP for all.